Well, everybody, this is Jason from STEM Nerds. Thank you so much for being here. We've got an important video today because we're going to be talking about cells and particularly what comprises a cell, cell organelles, the parts and pieces of a cell. Thanks so much for being here. Hope you enjoy the video. Yeah, so we've got these wonderful little things that we can see under a microscope. That's going to be coming in a future video. But we need to talk about the parts and pieces that make up the fundamental entity of a living thing, and that's a cell. In a previous video, we talked about all living things are made of cells, and there's different types. There's prokaryotic cells, there's eukaryotic cells, and we're going to dive a little bit deeper today and explain what that means. So let's go ahead and start simple. We're going to start with a bacterial cell. In other words, we're going to be starting with a prokaryotic cell, and that word prokaryotic means that the cell is pre-nucleus. It lacks a nucleus, and these cells lack membrane-bound organelles. And so generally speaking, we say two things about them. They are simpler forms of life compared to eukaryotic cells, and they are generally smaller cells in their overall size. And so this picture does a pretty good job of labeling the most important parts of a prokaryotic cell, a bacterial cell. I've added in some things that I think this picture leaves out, and I'm not going to talk about every single thing on this picture or in future ones. But I'm going to definitely highlight the most important, at least in my opinion, the most important structures that we're finding in each type of cell. So let's start here, bacterial cell. And so we can see here that inside you got all this purple stuff, and that purple stuff is the genetic material. Prokaryotes, generally speaking, have one large circular chromosome. And that circular chromosome houses all of the genetic information necessary under normal conditions. Some bacterial cells or some prokaryotic cells will have plasmids. That word is in the upper left-hand corner. And a plasmid is extra chromosomal DNA. In other words, plasmids are separate from the chromosome. And these plasmids are small circular pieces of DNA that often house some type of special genes, often when it comes to bacteria, genes that include antibiotic resistance or maybe being able to exploit a new food source. But the most important thing when it comes to plasmids is, once again, they're extra chromosomal outside the chromosome. They are not necessary under normal conditions. And bacterial cells can have one plasmid, they can have multiples, they can have different types of plasmids. And these plasmids can be transferred from one cell to another in something called horizontal gene transfer, something we talk about in a future video. Next thing, we're going to stay in the upper left-hand corner. Some prokaryotic cells can form endospores, and an endospore is like a protective coat over the cell, and when that happens, the cell goes into more or less a dormant state, and so the metabolism dramatically slows, the chemistry inside the cell changes dramatically, and when a cell is in an endospore form, it's highly resistant to drying out, which is called desiccation. Chemicals like disinfectants and antiseptics, it's resistant to antibiotics. Doesn't really matter how much oxygen is present because they're really not metabolizing at this point. And so endospores can last years, possibly even decades or more. The other thing to consider when it comes to prokaryotic cells is they have these things called ribosomes. And you can see that on the left-hand side as well. And ribosomes are responsible for making proteins. And the ribosomes of a bacterial cell look a little bit different than the ribosomes we would find in a eukaryotic cell like in human beings. And we'll talk more about that later. Bacteria have a cell membrane, as all cells do. And a cell membrane really is the barrier that separates the inside of the cell from the outside of the cell. And we're going to talk about the properties of cell membranes a little bit later in a future video. But cell membranes, again, what we need to know, and we kind of talked about them in the last video when we were discussing chemistry, but cell membranes are amphipathic, which means that there is a charged head of the cell membrane, and then there's these non-charged or hydrophobic tails, and that does a really good job of keeping things in the cell that need to be in there and keeping things out of the cell that aren't supposed to be in there. So it's selectively permeable. There's also a cell wall, and we're going to cover the cell wall in a future video in much greater detail, but the overwhelming majority of bacteria do have cell walls, and that cell wall is designed for protection and to maintain cell shape. And then in the lower left-hand corner, you're going to see I added a couple more vesicles and vacuoles, and these are primarily for transport and storage. On the lower right-hand side, you're going to see that I added the cytoskeleton, something that is far more predominant in eukaryotic cells, but a cytoskeleton does sometimes exist in prokaryotic cells. And the cytoskeleton can do lots of different things, but mostly it's there to maintain cell shape and rigidity. And then we have what I call the cell motility structures, and that's the flagellum. So flagellum is singular, flagella is plural. And flagella is primarily used for movement, and usually when cells are using flagella for movement, it's very fast, but it's not very controlled. And then you can see up in the upper left-hand corner, we've got the pilus, pili being plural, and the pili are actually used for multiple purposes. They have three purposes. The pili can be used for movement, motility. They can also be used to attach to things, and the pili can be used in a process called conjugation, something we talk about in a future video. Remember, we talked about how plasmids can be transferred from one cell to another. Well, often those plasmids are transferred through pili from one cell to another. So they can make a connection with another cell and transfer plasmids. So again, a prokaryotic cell is a relatively simple cell, especially when we compare them to the eukaryotic cell that we're going to talk about in a few minutes. This is kind of cool. This is a picture of something called mycoplasma bacteria. Mycoplasma bacteria are interesting because they lack a cell wall. They're one of the few types of bacteria that lack a cell wall. And so sometimes people can get infected with mycoplasma infections. And when that happens, it becomes a little bit problematic to treat because a lot of the antibiotics that we rely upon, something we'll talk about in a future video, they don't work so good with cells that don't have a cell wall. And before we get into the discussion about eukaryotic organisms, I just want to make sure we understand this concept of plasmids and chromosomal DNA again. Again, this is a bacterial cell. You can see the host chromosome that houses all the genetic information necessary under normal conditions. That's on the left-hand side in the blue. On the right-hand side, we have the depiction of plasmid DNA. And again, it's extra chromosomal. It is a prokaryotic structure, and it is independent. They replicate independently. Again, there can be one, there can be many different types. There can be many of the same type. And these are, again, most important for things like antibiotic resistance, and they can be transferred from one cell to another. All right, well, let's get into the eukaryotic cell. We can see we've got a lot more going on here. And when my students are studying this, I require them to know the cell structures and organelles for both prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. And so, again, I'm not going to cover every single thing on here. So if I skip it, I don't expect my students to know. You may have to if you're taking this, watching this video for another class, but I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to start with what I call the endomembrane system. Not what I call it, it's called that, but I like to start there. And so I like to organize my thoughts when it comes to cell structure and organelles, especially for eukaryotic cells. I highly recommend follow my lead here. Trust me, it's going to make life so much easier. So we're going to start with this thing called the endomembrane system. And basically what that is, it consists of the nucleus. And the nucleus is the location that houses DNA. It is a membrane-bound structure. And so eukaryotic cells have this thing called the nucleus, and they have membrane-bound organelles. And they are typically larger than prokaryotic cells, something we've talked about already in a previous video. So we've got the nucleus. Again, houses DNA. And then just outside of there, you're going to see something called the endoplasmic reticulum. We like to call it just the ER. And there's two different types. There's a rough ER and a smooth ER, and this is both part of the endomembrane system, and they have different jobs. So the rough ER, if you look at this picture, you're going to notice there's little red dots attached to the blue membrane. And you're also going to see that just above the rough ER, you're going to see ribosomes. We've already talked about ribosomes. They make proteins. And so the rough ER is also responsible for producing proteins. But the location of where the proteins are going to go, their final destination, is often going to be a little bit different. When ribosomes are just in the cytoplasm, like you see the little red dots everywhere in this picture, when they're just floating around the cytoplasm, when they're making proteins, usually those proteins are going to stay inside the cell. However, when ribosomes attach to the rough ER, often the proteins that are manufactured in the rough ER are either going to be embedded in the cell membrane or they're going to be secreted by the cell. Okay, so we have the rough ER makes proteins. Now the smooth ER, that label is on the right-hand side of your picture. The smooth ER has a different role. Smooth ER is responsible for manufacturing lipids. It's responsible for detoxification inside the cell, and it will also store calcium. And next we have the Golgi apparatus down there. It's part of the endomembrane system. I had noticed that this figure that I was using had a typo, and I had to change the Golgi because it said Goldie. So I noticed it. If you noticed it, very observant, but I went ahead and changed it so it's spelled correctly. So the Golgi apparatus is part of the endomembrane system. And what it does is it packages proteins. And I'm convinced many of my students don't actually know what that means, but they walk around with that information and it's good information. But what it means is proteins that are manufactured in the rough ER are eventually going to go to the Golgi apparatus. And the Golgi apparatus is responsible for ensuring their three-dimensional structure, making sure we talked about earlier, primary, secondary, tertiary, quaternary structure, making sure that that tertiary or quaternary structure, if needed, is happening there so the protein is folding properly. And then it gets packaged into vesicles and vacuoles. And those vesicles and vacuoles are going to allow that protein to either be embedded in the membrane or to leave the cell. All right, next thing I like to do is I like to cover the organelles that are responsible for breaking things down inside the cell. And there are two main ones. One of them is called a lysosome, and that label is on the right-hand side. And a lysosome, it is kind of like the cell stomach. It has an acidic internal environment, and as cells bring in food, the lysosome can break that down. Sometimes cells need to break down internal organelles. Lysosomes can break that down as well. Second digestive organelle, if you will, is the peroxisome. And what the peroxisomes do is their job's a little bit different. They detoxify hydrogen peroxide into water and oxygen gas. That hydrogen peroxide can be a byproduct of cellular metabolism as that's happening. We talk about that more in a future video. So remember, peroxisome, hydrogen peroxide. Up at the very top, we've got the mitochondria, and this is one we're going to be talking about in a little bit more detail here in a few minutes, because the mitochondria is responsible for manufacturing ATP. But the other thing that it does, and it's really important, the mitochondria has its own DNA, and it actually has its own ribosomes. And the ribosomes inside the mitochondria look a lot like the mitochondria that are look a lot like the ribosomes, I should say, that are found in prokaryotic organisms. But the mitochondria will also send signals to the cell when it's time for the cell to destroy itself, something we call apoptosis. It will also send signals to the cell to do something called autophagy, and that is break down old organelles that are no longer necessary. And so the mitochondria have this critical role. And if you think about it, again, the mitochondria are responsible for energy production. They make ATP. If a cell is starting to starve, the mitochondria are going to be the first organelles that really sense that, and they can send those signals to the rest of the cell saying, hey, we either need to break down some things to survive, or the cell itself just needs to go away. Also inside the cell, we have something called the cytoskeleton, something we briefly mentioned in prokaryotic cells. But here I want to dive a little bit deeper. We have three different components that I generally focus on. We have microtubules, intermediate fibers or filaments, and actin filaments. And so those are the three types. I'm going to talk more about those in a second, because I have a slide that is going to give you a little bit more information. As we look at the cell and we start to travel outside, we still have a cell membrane, because all cells have a cell membrane that separates the inside from the outside of the cell. For eukaryotic cells, some eukaryotic cells have cell walls. Animal cells do not, but plant cells will. There are some types of eukaryotic cells that do, but again, animal cells don't. On the outside of the cell, we have things like flagella, potentially not shown here, but there could be flagella for movement. And the other one for movement is cilia. All right, so I did want to take a closer look at the mitochondria, because this is going to be a really important organelle for us when we get into energy metabolism and ATP synthesis. And so the things I want to point out right now, again, has its own DNA, has its own ribosomes, and it has a double membrane. And that's really important, because that double membrane is going to allow the mitochondria to synthesize ATP, adenosine triphosphate, which is the energy currency inside the cell. So this is what it looks like. Lots of surface area there for ATP production. Again, we're going to see a lot more of this guy in a future video when we're talking about ATP synthesis. Also wanted to show you a picture of a lysosome. Again, these are membrane-bound organelles. Lysosomes, again, kind of like the cell stomach, usually the internal parts are going to be acidic, and it's really great for breaking down organic compounds. Sometimes if viruses get into a cell, the lysosome can break those down as well. This is a cool picture. I mentioned that cells, eukaryotic cells, can either have flagella or cilia. Flagella, usually going to be faster, but less controllable. Cilia, lots of them, those little hair extensions that you see off of this cell. And usually when cells are using cilia, the movement is a lot more controlled. Not quite as fast, but it really is a pretty cool movement. So I mentioned that cytoskeletal elements inside of a cell, and there was microtubules, intermediate fibers or filaments, actin filaments. And so what we need to know about the cytoskeletal elements is, generally speaking, the microtubules can be involved in either motility, internal motility for the cell, or it can be involved in structure. Intermediate fibers, for the most part, are structural components of a cell, and actin filaments are often involved in cell motility or movement as well. All right, so if we're going to have a conversation about cells, we should also include plant cells in this conversation, and plant cells share a lot in common with animal cells. The important exceptions, chloroplasts that are involved in capturing energy from the sun, visible light, and then turning that into usable energy that the plant can use. And then we've got, as I've already mentioned, cell walls as part of plants as well. All right, everyone, so I think that is a pretty decent overview of the cell structures, organelles, that are important inside of both prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. As always, thank you so much for being here. Have a great week.